This podcast contains adult language, descriptions of violence, sexual references, and other possibly offensive themes. Listener discretion is advised.
Welcome to this episode of Back to the Story, where friends come together to play Dungeons & Dragons. I'll be your DM, Klaus. Let's get started.
When you see God's Rust surrounded by armies,
I'm sorry, I couldn't buy us more time.
Then know that its dissolution has come near.
I mean, I have great faith in the gods. I think that no matter what happens, they're going to triumph over this.
Then let those who are upon the pinnacle flee to the mountains.
And it's not really our place to judge, but to serve.
Let those who are inside the city depart.
I think if you gave me a few days, I could learn enough deep speech to try.
And let not those who are out in the forest enter it.
I'm an archaeologist. Disrespecting the dead is kind of what I do.
For these are the days of vengeance.
I just want to know what the fuck I am.
To fulfill all that is written.
Do not heed the visions of false prophets. Do not become what they want you to become.
All right, Scales. It's up to you now. You got this.
Well, are you guys ready?
Define ready.
Red is a strong word.
Are you present? Do you have dice? Do you have your character sheets? Uh-huh. Okay. Because I'm not. Fuck. we'll get started without it. Episode 53, Life or Undeath. We have been looking up towards a broken sky, a scar like jagged glass is torn across the blanket of black. No stars, no clouds, only that shattered sky. Our vision bends down until we are looking over the shoulder of a man. He's hovering in the shadowed sky in scaled armor, wings of eagles holding him aloft. He looks down far below to the swarming horde of undead, the cavalry of vampiric chevelles, the flying batars of their mounts of giant bats. A quiet, unyielding expression forms across the man's face as he whispers, "All right, Scales, it's up to you now." The perspective slowly rotates around the figure to look upon his head as he holds his tree-like symbol before him, sparking a small sphere of sun around it. The light reveals the determined face of a man with a bushy brown beard and pearlescent green eyes. The wings cease their work as the man begins to fall, and air and shadow and world rush by him. The perspective shifts again. Far in the distance as we watch a burning, radiant light in the darkness fall like a star from the sky. As it nears the ground, the perspective rotates slowly around to see the face of a man watching the light fall in the distance through a window. Even from here, the light is bright enough to reveal a pale man with red eyes, pitch-black hair, and gilded armor. He watches with eyes wide at the sunlight. We suddenly snap, zoomed into the face of the man falling from the sky. The shadows and air rush all around him, the background blurred as we see him close his pearlescent eyes and smile. There's a sudden blinding burst of light, leaving a vision of searing white, which slowly fades to black. Remembrance of Ezekiel de Barbarac. Previously, as the Bronze Scales continued their diplomatic inquiry into Felnor, they found themselves locked in cells beneath the Umbakan architect embassy. Sensing something was wrong, they set out to gather Meli's arcane chalk necessary for their escape. The alarms were raised and chaos ensued. Vesper was manacled and beaten by whites and skeletons alike as they dragged her out of the embassy, and as Amzin waited with his charmer, the Batar Vampire. Baal, Ellery, Ezekiel, and Meli ascended the lift to find a force of undead and Umbak alike holding the hallway. The prepared enemies released an onslaught of arrow and poison, and as they began to fight their way out with hammer and fire, A glittering rift began to open next to Ellery. Slipping from it, a unicorn of silver with a glistening corkscrew horn stepped forth. Ezekiel, now in humanoid form, was able to locate Vesper's bag and convince the unicorn to take all of you to it, leaving Ezekiel behind. Pulling you through the rift, you came to a hall just at the entrance of the embassy. Here, the unicorn held off enemies from one end as the rest of the scales reunited with Vesper, whose life had been nearly drained from her by the whites, manacled, and her primary holy symbol ripped from her neck. Amzin stood outside, convinced by his Batar charmer that everything would be all right, even presenting his neck for the vampire to take in blood. Vesper was dragged outside as the rest of the scales pushed forward through enemies, tired and shadow-fatigued, towards Vesper and Amzin. Fighting a battle that might be their last, the scales give it their all, but the outcome looked dark until Melly banished the Batar, wiping the smirk and the rest of his form from this plane entirely. With the Batar gone, Amson's muddled mind suddenly became clear, but it may be too late. The whites, skeletons, and Umbok swarm upon you from both sides as the scales struggled to get the bags out. Brawn appeared and brought down jagged and frozen hunks of black ice upon you, bringing several to unconsciousness, just as the bags of holding were put together. We come back to the story here. You all hear a loud and strangely dissonant tearing sound. Not just of the bags, but of the fabric of planes itself. Like dashing lightning, the tears of violently pulsing arcane energy arc and reach across the enveloped bags. The tears widen and brighten until a sudden force pulls the bags together, disintegrating what is left of them, leaving only the collapsing tears of unbridled arcane energy. Two small planes crash into a singularity, and you with them. As we see the scales and the enemies around you pulled into the singularity of violet and blue the size of a marble, you all feel a crushing weight upon you. But not just your bodies, but your mind too. It feels as if you've lost your stomach, but from a sudden change in gravitational force, and also the very equivalent upon your psyche as well. Your sight is blinded by colors of all sort. Rushing by, the sound of racing lightning, a thunderous noise is heard from behind you, chasing. The feeling ends as quickly as it began. You are in shock. You see nothing but feel something cold and hard under you as you struggle back to your feet. You panic as you can't breathe, willing yourself with purposeful thought, sensing intimately your lungs expanding, the air rushing through your bronchi, crackling open the alveoli, some filled with bloody fluid. You're blind, but your eyes open, trying to consciously will them to focus, but you see a blurred vision of smeared colors and shapes. You see before you a sea of deep blue, but not quite liquid or gas, but plasma, perhaps. It stretches into eternity, and for a moment you see how small you are in the grand scale of time. In the sea you see passing discs, like galaxies of color spinning through the sea. You see binary stars circling each other as they move, leaving a double helix after trail of memories manifested. You see countless stars, as you've never seen them before. You can nearly sense their presence, their consciousness. They are more than specks of light in the void, but entities themselves. Your mind snaps back to the moment at hand. You're standing upon a massive pillar, seemingly floating in the sea. There are a number of smaller pillars surrounding this one. You stand upon strange green stone in a circle of pillars with an altar to one side. As you glance around the undead, an Umbok struggling to their feet as well, you see something massive in the astral sea beyond this place. A bony formation resembling a cracked skull of something massive beyond your comprehension. In the eye socket, there is an angry sphere of red lightning. There's a thunderous crack coming from the sea in the distance. You see a violent storm of blue and green rushing towards you in the form of a storm wall. The thunder rumbles and vibrates your chest as the lightning flashes to reveal the silhouette of a large figure standing tall, wings outstretched in the storm. As we come back to the story, everyone now has to intentionally think and will their legs and arms to move. Your speed is now equal to your intelligence score, not the modifier, the full score, multiplied by 3, rounded down to the nearest 5 feet. George, go ahead and roll initiative for your character.
15.
All right. So we're picking up initiative in the middle of the round. The scales and everyone that was pulled through with you are essentially stunned, more or less, recovering. George, your character sees this in a surprise initially, but will act in this round based on where you are in the initiative order. As we're considering the stun and the surprise canceling out, essentially. So, Ellery, we're picking back up with you, and let me move you all to the map. So, Ellery, we're picking back up with you. You've just used your action to push the bags together, but still have your bonus action and movement should you want to use them. What do you do?
Okay, so first of all, thank you for that punch in the heart in the remembrance. I think Ellery at this point, it has not really hit her yet, and she's pushing aside any thought of the choice that she just made. But looking around, seeing where everyone is, she reaches out for a third time to Valtamere's power and growls a word and casts Healing Word on Vesper. I thought I was prepared for today.
Oh, that's good.
9 points of healing damage. 9 points of healing damage to Vesper.
Ellery, as you call this word of healing out, and Vesper, some of your wounds heal and your eyes open, almost immediately in response, Ellery, to those words, you hear a thunderous response from the storm forming over to your right in the distance. That storm is rushing towards you, and as you whisper those words, the thunder roars, and a thin blue-green stream of lightning cracks from it and strikes Vesper, healing her wounds, cauterizing some of them. Vesper, you come to consciousness once more. You are on your back, on stone, standing above you is white. And if that's all for you, Ellery?
Looking around at where everybody is, I am staying exactly where I am.
Okay. That will bring us up to these guys. So the next to you, Ball, the two Umbok are going to lift their shields up to them and are effectively going to disengage as they back up.
Is that green stuff walkable on? What is that?
That is stone. Yeah, it's this like malachite marbled stone.
Okay.
So they move back. That brings us up to George, your character. You were staring off, thinking, deciding your next steps, and suddenly there's a loud noise behind you, and you see these individuals all burst through a tear. In reality, you're shocked initially, but now can act. As those of you conscious look over, and we'll do a brief description now and you can get into it after this settles down, a tan elf of some sort with numerous things and scrolls and such upon him.
Well, it's about damn time. Looks like you need a little help. And I will go 5, 10, 15, 20, 25. All right, get right here. Rushing up, drawing a dagger from my belt.
I pause real quick. I didn't realize the Zumbuck was still there. He would have disengaged and pulled back as well, just before, in case that involved him.
It did. So instead, I am going to... Where is Vesper right now?
She is underneath the top white.
All right. Seeing her on the ground...
There.
I am instead going to stay right where I was, and I am going to pull out a brush from my belt, and you watch as he kind of writes in the air this draconic symbol, and I will cast Sanctuary with my bonus action on Vesper, and then with my action, I will just continue the writing into what is much darker and deeper symbol and then a spiky black tentacle will shoot out of my brush, and I am going to cast Thorn Whip on this white here. So that is 16 plus 9, so 25.
Yes.
So he takes 6 piercing damage and is pulled towards me 10 feet.
And that tentacle wraps around him, pulling him towards you. You can see these two whites with pale skin and blue eyes, and this one is suddenly in your face, turning towards you.
And I just smirk.
Okay. That will bring us up to Ball.
So is Melly, are Melly and Amson both unconscious, or are they up?
I think for some reason.
They're both out. It's just you and Ellery who are up.
Okay. Well, I guess that kind of makes it easier. Since everyone that was blocking me from my friends is decided to move away from me, I'll take a step forward and use 3 points of Lay on Hands into Melly with my action. Unless I have to use 4. Did we decide what happens if I'm still on fire and I touch, like, and I try to heal Melly? Because I technically still have my Mantle of Flame on.
I think that only affects when they hit you.
Okay.
Yeah, so we'll say you can subdue the flames enough to get the heal through without also burning them.
Perfect. Okay, so healing Melly for 3 points, and then I'll just kind of get into melee range of this ghost in white.
And what's your intelligence modifier?
6,000.
Or, I'm sorry, your score.
It's 8.
Okay.
So I'll recount that just so it's 1, 2, 3, 4.
Okay.
So 20 feet, is that? I don't know the math for how you want to do it.
You should be good. Yeah, you should be good.
I think that's about it. That'll be the end of my turn.
Okay. That will bring us up to... As Paul finishes, that'll bring us up to Melly. So Melly, you are lying on your back and suddenly breathe in as you see Ball hovering over you. As he pulls away from you, his arm bursts back into flames as he shifts away. What do you do?
I stand up and I grab Ellery and then use my cloak thing, the dimension door, out of this middle bit.
Okay, where do you want to go? Assuming Ellery is willing.
Yeah.
Ellery is absolutely willing.
Moving. Okay. I'd say top left. So it's 500 feet, so if we go like all the way up here, maybe.
Yes, you can move yourself wherever it is you want.
Yeah.
To go.
Okay. Not be nothing.
Okay. So you stand up quickly, grab Ellery, whoosh, step through as your cape turns into smoke billowing around you. As there's a sudden streak of smoke that trails over to where you are as you poof back there. As you land, there's a sudden crack of thunder once more as you see the storm wall heading towards you. And peeking out of it, you see a figure beginning to emerge from the head of the storm. Massive, muscular, wearing armor, carrying or holding a javelin made out of lightning. You can see 4 wings spread aloft like sails. You can see this dark bluish green like skin as it moves at the point of the storm, seemingly leading it towards you as it gets closer. And that will lead us up to Vesper. Vesper, you are unconscious, conscious, but on your back with a white standing over you.
So I snapping open, the first thing I do is my usual field medic look around to see where everyone is, how they're doing, and I quickly do my head count and I stop, and I do it again, and I realize there are in fact only 5 of us. Bonus action to disengage, and I'm going to scramble this way.
And what's your intelligence score?
14. My movement is halved because of exhaustion.
Okay.
Then I'm going to get into my coat pocket and pull out one of the concentrated healing potions, and I'm going to feed it to Amson.
Okay.
I think it's 2d4+2. Yes. Of course, it's the minimum damage. Fuck these dice. 4 points of healing into Amson.
She quickly, eyes open wide, tuck and roll under the white's legs, quickly turning, getting over next to Amson, pulling it out, uncorking it, shoving in his mouth, flowing forth. As Amson's eyes open wide and soft.
And I think that's all I can do.
Okay. That will bring us up to Amson. Right. You've just regained consciousness.
Amson is, with Vesper, who's standing over him, is going to look at her as he regains consciousness, and she is the first thing he sees. And he's going to say, "Thank you," and just grab Vesper. And he'll use his one and only fifth level spell slot to cast Dimension Door, kind of near where Melly is.
Okay.
And then I don't have a bonus action anything left, so that's my turn.
Okay. That will bring us up to the whites. So, this one standing next to you, Ball, pulls something off the side of his belt. It steps up towards you and throws it onto the ground. It smashes as this green fume spreads out all around a familiar one. This begins to sear your outer skin, water your eyes, and burn into your lungs.
I quickly reseal the potion and give it back to him.
I'll roll it since we actually have. That is 3 points of poison damage to you. And that's his turn. And then the other one is going to, let's see how far this is going to throw it towards where you've all gathered over here.
Can I use my reaction to hold my breath?
You can certainly try.
If I see it coming at me and I've already seen one with fumes, my breath.
Sure.
Cool.
So this one, he throws it over towards you. It bursts. The fumes go out. You guys each take 2 points of damage. Vesper, you take 2 points as well as it begins to sear into your eyes and the external of your skin as well. Actually, I'll say half because it was mostly a respiratory poison, but it does sting on the outside as well. So 1 point of damage. So he throws that towards you and then turns back towards you, George, your character. That's all I can do. And then this guy. So there was a image that was kind of shifting in and out, and it's suddenly almost like static clarifies, and these multiple images that were all dissonant into one as you see a floating spectral form next to you, Ball. It is going to move towards you, Ball, reaching its hand towards you as it opens and unclenches its jaw that stretches out far. It tries to breathe you in a strange way. I need you to make a charisma saving throw.
Is that the same ghost as before?
Yes.
Ball automatically succeeds. He already tried to possess him.
I had no idea, so thank you. Because otherwise that's a 6.
If I remember ghost possession correctly. Once you succeed on the save, you are immune for 24 hours.
I think that's right. I made my own version, but it would still follow those same rules. May not have do that if it knew that, but I might just let it stand. Okay, so he is immune, and we'll say she tries it again because of bullshit. Even though she'd know, whatever. And that will bring us up to Ellery. At the start of your turn, you take 2 points of poison damage.
Lovely. Okay. I am first going to cast Eldritch Blast at that ghost. Both beams. That's a natural 20 on the first one. And 17 on the second.
Yeah, both hit.
So that is 21 points of force damage.
Okay. These two things slam into his back.
So that's
hurting it significantly.
That's my action. And then for my movement, I am going to try and drag Melly out of this gas.
Okay, so what's your intelligence?
My intelligence is 10, so I should have 30 feet.
So 15,
and then half of that,
her.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I'm going this way and then down.
Okay. You can do that. Yes, you lay the blast crab Melly Dragger out of this poison.
And I am going to...
So you just have a bonus left if you have anything.
So bonus action, healing word first level on Melly for 6 points.
Again, the storm closer now. The small lightning bolt slams into Melly, healing some of her wounds. All right, okay, that's you. That'll bring us up to here. This guy slides to the side, drops his hammer, pulls out a crossbow, and fires it towards you, Ellery. That is a 13 plus 17.
Nope.
So he fires, the bolt goes over, and he's going to fire that again. 21 this time.
Does he have crossbow expert?
This guy's a trained guard, he does.
All right, just check it.
I'm not doing that great, so I am going to throw up my free arm and cast shield.
Okay. So the bolt comes towards you. You break it away. It's a shield of thunder this time. Less of a physical thing, but it just shatters the bolt to nothing. So that's this guy. That guy's going to go towards you, and then this guy's going to shift. So two towards ball, 19, and a 10 towards ball.
19 hits.
Take 8 points of piercing damage as this guy's shifting to the side, launches two bolts to you. One of them slams into your armor. The other one sinks in.
And ball's unconscious.
As ball falls down in the poison, this last one is going to fire towards George's character.
Ball has the thing, doesn't he?
There's no. I'm standing in poison, so as soon as I use it, I'll just die again anyway, so there's no point.
Fair.
Yeah. So that is a 17 to hit George.
Miss.
And then, so miss. Towards you, you're locking eyes with the white, but you notice it out of the corner of your eye. You should move back. What kind of armor are you wearing? Medium? Or?
I have scale mail and a shield.
Okay. So one of them flies over your shoulder, the other one slams into your shield to no effect, and he's now going to move. He's going to stay there. That's a good spot for him. And that will bring us up to towards your character. As you're facing off this white, as a few crossbow bolts are moving towards you, poison clouds in the air.
Okay. I'm just going to look at him. My eyes kind of narrow. A wooden bangle on my wrist. There's script on it that glows pink, and I'm going to cast Dissonant Whispers on him. So that is a wisdom saving
throw. That is a 13.
That will fail.
14, so. Yeah.
So he takes 11 psychic damage and must immediately use his reaction to run away from me.
Okay, with his movement speed?
Yep. And okay. As soon as he steps away, I'm going to use my reaction with Warcaster to cast Booming Blade on him.
Okay.
27 a hit.
Hits.
So that is 8 piercing damage and 12 thunder altogether because he takes the thunder damage from moving.
Okay. His pale ice blue eyes grow wide as these whispers go into his ear. His eyes are darting around wondering what's happening. Looks back up at you. As you smirk, as it takes a step back, turns to run, and as he does, the booming blade sets off. What does that look like as you do that? It kills him, by the way.
So, yeah, I'll stab him with my dagger, which kind of pulses, and then when he takes another step, there's another vibration that just makes him fall.
And immediately the skin withers to nothing, and it's just bones that are tossed. A few fall off the pillar down into the sea of astral light.
And then with my bonus action, I will hold up that arm with the bracelet again, and a pink floating head, kind of spectral shape, manifests and floats above Ball.
Okay. Is that it for you, George?
Yes.
Okay. That brings up to Ball, which I guess I don't need to roll, but Ball, you take damage at the start of your turn and make one death fail from that poison, and then roll a death saving throw.
as he's doing that, I am going to move because I forgot I can do that. I should have 60 feet, so I'm going to go ahead and charge toward this guy.
Okay. So as the elf runs towards this dwarf or umbok ball, you have one fail and one save. As that sphere is floating above his unconscious form, that will bring us up to Melly. You've been dragged by Ellery out of the poisonous cloud. It's your turn.
Did I see which one shot Ellery?
It's the one to the south of you, directly.
I will move next to Ellery and I will shoot a ray of frost at him.
Okay.
26.
Oh, yeah. Melly slings the ice, slamming into him, kind of knocking him, his shoulder off the side before he grabs the crossbow again.
Oh, that's okay.
Okay. As this is happening, there's a loud crack of lightning and thunder. As the storm gets closer and closer, the figure at the head of the storm is now beginning to pull ahead of the storm and is holding their hand out to the side as that javelin begins to elongate into a spear of lightning. That will bring us up to Vesper.
Nazzy. Any damage though I'm holding my breath, or am I good?
At the start of your turn, it'll take half, so you'll take 2 points of damage.
Okay.
Of poison damage.
Yes. So then I'm gonna shove the last concentrated potion into Amson's hand, give his hand a squeeze, and then I'm gonna move 5, 10, 15, and 20. Oh, no, 20. With my bonus action, I'm going to healing word ball. That's 9 points of healing back to you, and because I'm a blessed healer, I get 3 points for myself.
And, Ball, you've been unconscious once?
I have one despair, and this is my first time going unconscious, so I have exhaustion level 2.
Correct. So your speed is halved, and then disadvantage on checks. Vesper, anything else for you? And Vesper, what level of exhaustion are you at?
I'm at 4. I don't know if I can do anything else. Oh, I'm going to use my action to dash and get further away from that.
Okay. So
5, 10, 15, 20.
And just a reminder, did you have despair as well?
I did. So with a despair, I'm at 4 levels.
That's part of the 4. Okay.
Yes.
So you have disadvantage on check, speed half, disadvantage on attacks and saves, and then hit point max reduced to 0.
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Or reduced.
Reduced to half. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, not 0. Sorry.
I've got the table. I know.
Okay, perfect.
I've been keeping an eye on it.
Just want to make sure. Okay, so that's your turn. That'll bring us up to Amson. Start your turn. You take 2 points of poison damage.
I'm unconscious.
As Amson falls unconscious in the poison. So that's your turn. That brings up to the whites, or white at this point. Seeing Ball back up is going to reach out towards Ball with its life drain. Once it has advantage, where you're currently on your back. And that is a dirty 20.
Yeah, I'll use my reaction to I'm going to use a second level spell slot. That's the lowest I've got to shield so he can't hit me.
Okay. Raises, and then he's going to come down with this longsword. Still with advantage. I'm going to count 23. But you still have the shield bonus.
Right, so it doesn't hit. Just barely misses.
Reaches out with his hand as that energy begins to draw from you. As you pull your hand up and fire envelops and burns the energy away, he then brings a long sword down and hits a wall of flames as solid as rock. And that will bring us up to the ghost. At this point, he is going to reach out towards Ball. And this time, instead of breathing you in, she pulls both of her hands towards your head and almost tries to rip the life from you with her withering touch. 22 to hit?
No.
Okay. You can feel this necrotic energy pulling from her. And that will bring us up to Ellery.
I think Ellery is feeling a little bit panicked again. So I will cast Storm Sphere at 5th level, because that's what I have, centered here, which should hit all 3 of those umboks and not Ball.
Fail. That might be okay. And an 18.
Yeah, that one succeeds. So the one that succeeds, which one is that?
One closest to George's character.
Okay.
The furthest one from you.
So that one takes no damage. The other two take 12 points of bludgeoning damage.
As the storm appears and the thunder begins to pick up loose rocks and crystals and swirl them around, knocking them against their armor, the one on the edge is kind of shielding it as best it can. The others are taking the brunt of the force. What else for you, Valerie?
Bonus action. I am going to send a strike of lightning out from the center of the sphere to the ghost.
Okay.
And that is 16 to hit.
That hits.
Okay. And that's not the best I've done with that. 14 points of lightning damage to the ghost.
The lightning arcs from the sphere, slamming into her. The energy hits her and pushes her back a little bit, but it seems to take in some of it as well, and it doesn't hurt as much as you'd like it to.
And then how far down does this ledge go that's right next to me?
Looking over briefly, I mean, maybe 80-ish feet.
Okay. So not something I want to actually drop down.
Maybe your bonus, your action. So you have movement left.
I am going to say, come on, Melly. And then I'm going to run 30 feet towards the north, towards the north end of this platform.
Okay. You hold your breath as you sprint through the poison cloud, passing Hamson's body on your left in it. As you get there, that will bring us up to these guys. He's going to fire at Melly. That is a 18 against Melly.
Yep, I hit.
Okay. And that is 7 points of piercing damage as it fires two crossbow bolts. The first one you can get out of the way. The second one drives into your lower thigh, kind of pushing you down.
Into unconsciousness.
As you fall back onto your back, there's that guy. This guy is going to... He's going to just get out of it. He's going to dash out of it. And he's going to get there. This guy, he's going to drop his crossbow. And he's going to get out of it. Georgiou would get an attack of opportunity.
I already used my reaction at the top of my turn, so I don't.
So he gets out of it, throwing the crossbow to the ground. He has his hammer, but he can't pull it out. So he's going to grab you. So that is a athletics or acrobatics check for you.
23.
He's good, but not that good. He grabs onto you and begins to pull you towards the storm. You twist, turn, rotate, and slap his hands away as it pulls him back. And at this point, he's going to try to kick you. I'll make another athletics or acrobatics check.
Less good, 10.
He wasn't very good either, but he rolled an 11 as he kicks you as you fall prone onto your back.
Okay.
So there's that guy. I think that's all of them. That'll bring us up to Felix, actually, you. So you're on your back. This one back standing over you, beginning to pull out his hammer.
Okay. I'll just stand up. And then I am going to turn and look at the ghost. And my little floating head is actually going to drift forward and merge with it. And I am going to do information overload. So it has to make an intelligence saving throw.
Not great. That is a 12.
Nope. So it is going to take 2d8 plus 5 psychic, and I am going to drop a second level spell slot to increase that to 5d8. 26 psychic damage.
As this occurs and the head merges with the form, briefly, the form shimmers and reverts into this similarly ethereal and translucent form, but one of a humanoid female. Not undead, not with the elongated form, just a scared humanoid, terrified, eyes wide, just looking around, shaking. Anything else for you, George?
I am debating. No, ball's about to go. She still has Sanctuary. Do I have any other bonus actions? Yeah, I'm going to take the opportunity attack and move. I should still have 30 feet. Just want to get close enough. Yeah, I'm going to have to get in the poison. I will jump in and jump out.
Go ahead and make an acrobatics or athletics check.
Acrobatics, because I'm better at that. That is a 19.
As you stand up to your feet and turn to be able to run, you feel a arm wrap around your collarbone and pull you back. You still have the rest of your turn.
I'm trying to remember the order, if it's worth it. That's going to be it. I won't use my bonus this turn.
Okay. So your eyes are darting around, calculating, determining what is the next best move. And that will bring us up to Ball, who takes 3 points of poison damage as you're on your back, I believe, still in the poison cloud.
Nah. So as I'm just kind of, what's this poison cloud look like?
It's this green vaporous fume. You can see the part kind of behind you is beginning to be torn away by the storm.
Is it just kind of like one of those thick fumes that kind of hug the ground?
It's like it would be lightly obscured, but yeah, it's kind of this heavy green sphere. You can see through, but it kind of blurs your vision as you're in it, your eyes watering.
All right, so with my just like kind of regaining consciousness, being struck in the back by the crossbow, and then just barely fighting to stay alive here, Ball's going to, with his bonus action, use his mantle of flame. And as he does with his action, he's going to use his racial and just breathe fire onto them. So he just, like, at the same time that he's kind of, you know, just with frustration from how the fight's going and just all the pent up emotion, just kind of explodes in a big burst of fire, and then with kind of fumes of fire kind of spreading out through his mouth.
Okay. And is that towards, I assume, the ghost in the white next to you?
Yes, or the girl in the white, whatever it is now.
Yeah, so it's currently a scared, frightened, ethereal-looking humanoid. Dex saves?
Yes, dex save. It needs to be to 15.
16, and then not as good. 7. So it should be 3d6 for you right now.
Okay, so 3d6 plus my charisma modifier, so 13 fire damage, halved to 6, I believe.
Okay.
And then with my movement, I'm just going to stand up.
Okay. So as this occurs, you stand up, bursting flames all around you. As you roar, the flames move out, cascading towards the frightened ethereal girl who is wiped away by them. The flames lick over the white remaining as he bears it, gritting his undead teeth, and remains standing. So you're now standing. Is that it for your turn?
Yes, that's all I can do. So I just kind of lock eyes with it. Okay. Grit my teeth.
Locking eyes with the ice blue eyes, that'll bring us up to Melly, unconscious. Roll a death saving throw.
That's a 9.
Is this your first one of the day? Or did you make one before?
I don't think I ever made one for her.
So you get advantage.
Advantage. So roll again.
18.
Okay. That is one success for Melly. As the storm begins to get closer and closer, you can see the figure with wings, this angelic figure, is beginning to ride ahead of the storm. It started maybe a mile, 2 miles away, and this figure is now out flying the storm and is moving towards you with haste. We'll soon be fairly close. That'll bring us up to Vesper.
God damn it. I'm going to healing word Amsmith. My bonus action. That sucks. 7. And I'm going to go 5, 10, and just kind of get up here. Does the white, is he wearing any kind of helmet or anything like that?
It doesn't appear to be.
Okay, but the Umbok are, correct?
Correct.
Or should I have to touch it? Okay, never mind. My name is Swan, I'm 24, I've never learned how to read. So, that's my turn, I think.
Okay. That'll bring us up to Amson, who regains consciousness in the poison cloud, taking 2 points of poison damage, and it's up to you.
Okay, so I have an action potion. Not the one that Vesper gave me, but one of my own. So I'm going to drink that for 2d4 plus 2, which is 6. So I have 11 hit points now. And then I'm going to spend one of my two third level spells to cast Healing Word at third level on Ellie. Oh, that's good. That's 12 hit points.
Timeli, you suddenly breathe and regaining consciousness once more. You should have two levels of exhaustion at this point.
And then I'm going to use half movement to stand up in this place.
Okay. Correct.
And then so my intelligence is 16, so 48, 45, half to 20.
Yeah.
So 10 to get up, and then I'll move. I can't get out, but I'll get close to just about out. That's my turn.
Okay. And how many exhaustion levels do you have, Amson? One, despair?
I currently have 3.
Okay. So, Amson, you're moving away from the poison still in it, currently trying to get out. That'll bring us up to the white, which at this point is going to reach out towards you, Ball. Strike. You're standing, so it doesn't get advantage. And that is a 19.
That just hits.
Dealing, as it reaches out with the dark crimson energy, drawing in 13 points of necrotic damage, and then you need to make a constitution saving throw.
That's a 20 for a constitution saving throw.
Okay, so your maximum hit points are not reduced by that amount. You do take 13 points of necrotic damage.
So I would normally fall unconscious. Ball is going to use his reaction to Phoenix Spark, and essentially similar to the Orc Racial.
Sure.
So again, I guess the white hits Ball, and just for a moment, it seems like Ball's eyes are going to close again. And when he blinks, instead when he reopens his eyes, just like fire comes out of just like every orifice he has. And it does sorcerer level plus double your charisma modifier. So 13 fire damage to everyone in a 10-foot radius.
Okay. So as Ball's eyes begin to close, they flicker open, the flames rush out as you regain your footing. The flames roaring over the white as he drops to one knee. You can see the flames are licking up. He once had this stark white hair and is now at this point burnt off. You can see some of the leathers of his armors are burnt from these flames and the flames before as he's on his knees breathing. And begins to get up to his feet just barely. And is going to strike you with his last longsword. And that is a dirty 20 to hit.
That will hit.
And that's 9 slashing as he drives this double serrated serpentine longsword into a chink in some of your mail, of your horse chain mails after it's been damaged, driving it into your flesh.
This time, rather than fire coming out of every orifice, you just kind of see like lingering smoke just kind of fade out of his eyes and his mouth as Ball goes unconscious.
The flames.
Do I need to make another constitution save?
Not for this. No, it's just for the life drain. The sword doesn't have it. The flames upon enveloping Ball flicker out. What's left is smoke rolling out of his mouth. His eyes are like burnt out coals that are slowly dying as he teeters out and falls back as the white is just holding in that stance, barely standing up, holding that blade as Ball, falling, withdraws it from his form. And he's going to, with that, look up and see the closest target. He's going to get up in Vesper's face, and that's it for his turn. And that opens up to the ghost, which is dead.
There we go. I'm muted. Reaction to move half my movement and get away from him.
Okay. So you see him scrambling up towards you as you quickly shift
five
and get out
and
of there.
10.
Okay. And that'll bring us up to Ellery.
Okay. Bonus action. Lightning from the storm sphere at that fucking white.
Okay. We can attack roll.
Okay. That is good. That is a 25.
Yeah, it hits.
Then it is...
You don't have to roll for damage. There's no need.
Okay. So that's my bonus action.
So suddenly, this loud crack of lightning slams into his back as it launches his body forward. He's still dragging across the ground towards Vesper, eyes locked as the skin withers away to bones and then clatter to the ground. Hillary.
And I run forward into the poison in the middle, where the ghost was once floating, and I take out this healing potion that I've been holding onto for a while and pour it down Ball's throat.
Where were you, Hillary?
I was 25 feet away.
Okay, cool. So you run into the poison, throwing it into Ball's mouth. And it's the action to deliver a bonus action and some of your movement. Oh, I can't see you, that's why.
Yeah, I'm underneath the ghost at the moment. I believe that was 2d4 plus...
It's 2.
Okay. Good. 7 plus 2 is 9.
Thank you.
As Ball comes back once more, Ellery, you take 4 points of poison damage. And Ball, how many exhaustion levels are you at? 4 now?
3 now.
3, okay.
And I'm going to use my last 5 feet to run back up.
Okay. And that will bring us up to these guys. This one's going to aim toward Melly, who's right there.
She's still prone, by the way.
Oh, she is? Oh, well, they wouldn't do that then. Instead, they're going to aim towards Vesper. Or, I'm sorry, Ellery. That is a... Why can't I remember their stats? 19?
No.
And a 21.
That one hits.
Dealing 8 points of piercing damage.
Okay.
As one goes over your shoulder, the other one slams into you, kind of jostling to the side, but go ahead and make a constitution saving throw for Storm Sphere.
Okay. That's dirty 20.
Yeah, you're good. And otherwise, he is going to rush up. And this one is going to fire towards you as well, Ellery.
Is there a cover bonus here?
I can't see the...
Yeah, there's a pillar right there.
Okay, I can't see the pillars. Okay. He would just shoot before he got there. So he would just shoot. Continue to move. So that is a 18?
No.
And then I forgot what the second one was, so I'll re-roll it. And that one is a 23.
Yes.
Dealing 6 piercing damage as another arrow sinks into your bolt.
I fall.
Ellery falls. The storm sphere immediately dissipates. And then the third one is going to, having George's character in a chokehold, is going to take with his other hand, pulls out his hammer, is going to whack at your legs, trying to chop at your knees. That is a natural 1. And that is a 18.
Nope. So 19.
He cracks down towards your knee. You sidestep him as it cracks into the ground. He tries to pull it back and recover into a second swing, but you're already using his momentum to shift and spin him around. And you're kind of locked into this combat with him, but he isn't able to hit you. And that will bring us up to you, George.
Okay. I am going to ignore the guy on me for right now. I will use my bonus action to move my floaty head. 20, I think, is all I can move it. And then I'm going to once again cast Dissonant Whispers on the one that's next to Melly from the head.
Okay. So you see this Umbok has dropped the crossbows, pulling out the hammer, looking down at Melly. That is a natural 16, 17.
Okay, so it will pass it just barely, but it still takes half damage. Not great. 4, 7, 12, so 6 psychic damage.
As these whispers run through his ears, you can see he's almost like takes a step back before taking a step forward again. Is the spectral head, is it visible or just to you?
No, it is definitely visible. In fact, it glows in a 5-foot radius around it. So
okay, and then it emerges into his head.
That's for intellect overload. This is actually my same dissonant whisper. My eyes glow similar, and the spell gets cast through the head instead.
Okay. As he's kind of like shaking, trying to figure out what's going on, trying to regain his bearings. What else for you, George?
That will be it, because I can't move.
And that will bring us up to Ball.
Of these two guys that I can just barely see, which one looks more roughed up?
They look roughly equal. I mean, just glancing over there, they look about the same.
What I will do is, seeing them closing in on Nelly, Ball's going to rummage through, pull out an orange potion, where smoke fills the top of the container. He's going to open it up, take a big swig, and with his bonus action, he is going to spit fire at this guy right here. It is a DC 13 dex save, and that was a potion of fire breathing.
Okay, you take 2 points of poison damage at the start as you get up, popping this potion. You burp a little bit as flames and smoke roll out as your eyes are struggling to maintain ignition.
All right, I guess I'll get up before I spit fire.
Yeah, I assume you do. As the flames roar out towards him, that is a 14.
I think it's half, right?
He takes half, yeah.
Yeah, it's a DC 13. Yeah, so 5 fire damage.
Okay. See, this one, he kind of tilts to the side. He doesn't have his shield anymore, but he kind of tilts to the side as the flames roar over his shoulder and burning into that side of his face. As he turns back to you after the flames dissipate, the left side of his face, his eyes closed, that side burnt. He's looking very rough at this point. Still standing, but rough.
How much move speed do I have? I used half of my move speed to get up.
So 24, 20, 10 to get up. So you have 10 feet left.
I don't know how far I can. Can I move onto here, or is this considered blocking me?
That column's going to kind of be in the way for you just because of your size.
Okay.
I could say you could do it.
Maybe
yeah, I'm okay with that. You don't take up the full 4 squares.
That's right. I'll go here. This kind of protects. I'll just say Ball can kind of shield Ellery this way.
Okay. It's fine either way. Okay, so that's your movement action bonus. Is that everything for you, Paul?
Yeah, that's everything.
Okay. Send up, burn the flames, shifting over, standing next to Ellery on the ground. That will bring us up to Melly. As you're on the ground, and Umbok standing above you.
Can I stand up and scoot around him?
Yeah, so you stand up with half of your movement. I will remind you, attacks of opportunity are triggered by even moving within ranges, unless you disengage, which requires an action. You can 5-foot shift if you just want to move 5 feet.
I do want to move 5 feet.
Well, you would have to stand up is the thing, though.
Can I just
crawl? Can't you do a 5-foot
if
crawl?
You stay on the ground, I'll say you can 5-foot crawl, sure.
If I go here, is that allowed?
That would cut through his corner, so you wouldn't be able to do that. But I'll say you can basically roll 5 feet from where you were.
If I go there, can I burning hands and reach both of them?
15 feet, right?
Yeah.
You wouldn't be able to hit the other one. You can hit this one, but not the other one.
Then I won't do that. And I'll just grasp this guy next to me instead.
Okay.
What if you
are you standing up first?
Can you do that?
Pardon?
If you roll under him, can she reach both of them?
So are you standing up first or just doing it from the ground?
I will stand up first and then try that, and then maybe run away. We'll see how it goes.
He is wearing metal. Very heavy metal.
18.
Yeah, that hits.
So that's 9 points of damage and he can't take a reaction. So I am going to move away.
Okay. So you stand up. So it locks up his muscles briefly, allowing you to move.
You should still have 30 feet with your intelligence.
Yes, I will do that then. If I can go like that. All right.
So that'd take 25 to get there. So you have 5 more.
Oh, then I'm just a little bit further.
Okay. So Melly, you shock and shift away. Anything else for you?
Nope, that's my turn.
Okay. You guys hear this crackling sound as you look over and you see that figure. Now looking a feminine form as it's getting closer. Shaved head, this greenish blue tint skin, massive, maybe taller than Ball, is jutting towards you. It and slings a spear of lightning down towards you. It slams into the stone next to where the whites are. As it travels through the air, it is this lightning form. As it slams into it, there's a burst of lightning before the form of lightning solidifies into this like galvanized, jagged, elongated stone that's impaled into the ground. As it hits it, there's a thunderous noise. As you hear a voice rumble out in Celestial. I'm not sure who speaks that.
Wait, well, I was...
Do you speak Celestial?
You've spoken it before.
I do speak Celestial, yeah.
Oh, good.
Okay. You hear this feminine voice, but powerful, roar out like thunder. Enemies of gods, lay down your weapons or face the storm. As she is rushing towards you, less gravelly, but, you know, that's what all I can do for now. So she is incipient upon your location. That'll bring us up to Vesper.
Fun. Okay. I don't know what she said. So I'm going to get up here. What is this thing and can I climb on it?
It's an altar. And yeah, you can. It's only about maybe 4 foot tall.
Okay. I shouldn't be in poison. I will get on top of it and I will bonus action healing word Ellery with my last spell slot. So 7 to you.
Ellery, yeah, come in. Immediately start coughing from the poison once more.
It's 3 to me. And then I'm with my action, I'm going to cast Thaumaturgy on myself and make my voice 3 times as loud, since I should still have tongues.
Okay, so you understood what it said.
Oh, that's right. Oh, hey.
Wait, do you still have tongues?
I do still have tongues.
Is that a concentration spell?
It is not. It just lasts for an hour. So I do understand what that said. It can understand what I'm saying. I'm going to look at the nearest Wombok and basically try and lock eyes with it and go, your whites and ghosts have fallen. You're far from home. Give up now and we might spare you. And try and get them to see the fact that they're fucked, right?
Make an intimidation check. This is your action if you're...
Yes, a disadvantage?
Or, yeah.
Cool. Yeah. Really bad.
Is it a straight roll considering the situation?
Half of you are halfway dead.
It's still bad. It's it.
Okay. They look towards you, but one I'm sort of recovering from being shot by lightning. The other one is still trying to grapple onto Felix, swinging at his legs. They don't even seem to hear you. Like they hear words, but not really comprehend them. That should bring us up to Amson, who takes 3 points of poison damage at the start of your turn. So running out of the poison cloud.
Okie dokie. 1, 2, 3. Okay, so now that Melly's out of there, that's good. Because then I'm going to do something other than what I was thinking. And I'm going to render them rather useless, hopefully, for at least a turn, and cast Fog Cloud on the, centered in between the two of them, kind of. And then just completely cover them in fog so that they can't see anything.
As this burst of fog envelops them, as you can't see them, and they presumably also can't see you. Anything else for you, Amson?
Way bigger than that, but yeah.
Yeah, I'm getting there.
I'm going to jump out of the poison.
Okay.
Yep. Yeah. But that's my... Actually, no, I'm going to drink that poison... poison. Bonus action potion that Vesper gave me for 8.
Okay. And that will bring us up to these guys, which are dead, and to Ellery, which you take poison damage at the start of your turn. You have 1 death fail, and then go ahead and roll as well.
But Vesper just got me up.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, so you're up.
How much poison damage do I take?
2.
So I'm not 2. Looking great still.
What's your exhaustion level at?
2.
2, okay. Is that including the despair?
Yes, so there's the despair, and I only went unconscious that time. Okay. I'm not going to bother to stand up. I'm because my speed is halved, I'm just going to crawl out of the fog in the direction of Melly.
It's double movement to crawl.
It is?
Yeah. Yeah, you can't run as fast as you, or you can't crawl as fast as you can.
So,
I mean, she can roll, but it's going to be mechanically the same thing. So you could get there if you're crawling.
I'm still stuck partway in the fog, in the poison cloud. Then, I'm going to take my action to dash to get the rest of the way out of it.
Okay.
And then, who looks worst?
I'll say just quickly glancing around, everyone looks pretty hurt.
Everyone looks worst.
Vesper maybe is less worse, but everyone is... Well, I don't know. Everyone.
I would say overall, Vesper looks the worst because I think I have the most levels of exhaustion. But I'm not. I have 15 hit points.
Without like using a check to see you, they all look bad. Everyone looks bad.
Ball is still in the most immediate danger, and he's partway in the fog, in the poison cloud. So I am going to use my last healing word at third level.
Counterspell.
3, 6, 10, 12. 12 points of healing damage to Ball.
Unconscious.
You're conscious. So that is your movement, your action, and your bonus action.
Yes.
So that will bring us up to these guys. So they are going to... Ball, were you standing up or laying down? Okay, I thought you were. Oh, yeah, because you did the flames. So the flames of the fire breath potion are still kind of flowing and turning and curling out of your mouth. Standing up, they are going to fire at you. They can't see you, so that's disadvantage, but you can't see. Is that how that works, or do they have to actually hide?
They actually have to hide as far as...
Is that how that works? Or they can't... George, do you have a ruling? Because you did the Rex in the...
Yeah, technically, because they can't see each other, it would be a moot thing. It's just a straight roll.
Okay. This one was going to hit Melly, so he didn't have his crossbow out, so he's going to rush up to Ball. He's going to attack. That is a 14 to hit you, Ball.
9.
And a dirty 20 to hit you.
Duh.
There's my other D10. That is a 11 bludgeoning damage as the first one comes up, slamming into the side of your leg, but you're able to kind of move with the force, the ping in your leg. As you limp slightly, another hammer comes into your stomach, slams in. So that's him. And this one still had his crossbow out, and he's going to just fire from where he is towards you, Ball. Blind.
Do I get any kind of cover, or does it, I guess it doesn't matter?
I can't see these, damn.
There's a pillar in between him and Ball.
Almost directly.
He's gonna move up. He did see it before the fog came. So he's gonna
move
up.
Is he able to orient himself in the fog?
He can run forward blindly. That is a 22 to hit.
So I don't go unconscious. I'm going to use my level 4 spell, my very last one, for shield.
Okay. So instead that...
So that's a miss.
Okay. And this is on this second onslaught. Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I can't retroactively use it.
Okay. So that one would have been 22, and then the second attack is less. So two bolts come out of the fog. You can't see them, but a wall of flame kind of prevents them and burns them up before they get to you. And then this last one is going to drag you, Felix. So 5, 10, edge. And he's going to dash. And he's going to go off the edge.
Do I have any defense against that?
Like, I have no idea. Do you?
I mean, like, what physically, I guess they don't count on them doing it. Do I get a save or anything as he tries to pull me off?
He begins to drag you off towards the edge. So you're currently at the edge and beginning to fall. You haven't lost sight of the top of this pillar.
Is he still grabbed onto me or what?
Yeah, he's grappled to you at this point too.
Okay.
Next time on Back to the Story.
Lay down your weapons or die.
Do you know where we are?
The storm is still rumbling around, but you do hear an additional scraping sound coming from deeper within the staircase.
I was unconscious when we left. Did he make it to us at all? Or was he?
The closer you get, your vision begins to blur at the brightness of it.
For part 2 of this episode of Back to the Story, you can find it on Stitcher, Google Play, Player FM, or TuneIn. We also have a YouTube channel called Back to the Story, an Actual Play Podcast. If you'd like to support the show, feel free to buy us a coffee at ko-fi.com/backtothestory.